Hello, everybody. Welcome. I take it you can hear me quite well, right? My name is Eva Heikkilä, and I'm the chair of the Human Rights Lawyers Association. I am a barrister, and I specialize in human rights law in garden court chambers. Now, to kick off the event, I will make some very brief remarks. I want to tell you about a very small incident in Oulu, northern Finland, where I come from. That is where we spend our summers as a family. And 4th of August, the local police announced that the windows of a very small mosque had been stoned. And why am I mentioning this seemingly marginal, faraway incident is that to me this demonstrates that we really live in a time of great upheaval. This is the time when masses of people are on the move, climate is changing rapidly, and the financial structures have fallen off the rails. Maybe they have been put back since, but we'll see. The Brexit debate, namely the debate leading to Brexit, and the events since demonstrate how easy it is to turn people against each other. We see terrifying signs of this in the United States. Here in Finland, United States, and everywhere, we see the insensitivity towards refugees, how easily it is to dehumanize the others, those people who we don't know, who speak different language, and maybe have different faith or no faith at all. At this time, in these kind of circumstances, it is the job for Human Rights Law Association, for Liberty, and our host to look for ways to highlight the importance of human rights and the need to keep human rights part of our everyday lives. It is not a bad term. The Human Rights Law Association and Liberty, we aim to increase the knowledge and understanding of human rights law and policy and to aid their implementation. We're open to everybody, whether you're practicing in law or a student or simply interested in human rights and work in a completely different field. If this is something that resonates with you, please, for Human Rights Law Association, contact our administrator, who is somewhere here. There. I'm very, very honoured to welcome Baroness Kennedy and Martha Spurrier here tonight. The timing couldn't be more pertinent, the need couldn't be greater, and the quality of the speakers couldn't be higher. At this point, I hand over to Charles. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Eva. On behalf of Hogan Lovells, I'm delighted to welcome everyone here this evening to what is a very important discussion. And I'm delighted to take the opportunity, despite Eva's invitation, implicit in what she just said, to not mention Brexit again for hopefully at least the next 5 minutes, if not the next hour and a half. 15 years ago, standing up here in this auditorium and saying that I am a human rights lawyer would have, at least in this setting, raised a few sceptical eyebrows. Now, for good or ill, we, not just those of us in this room, but we all are human rights lawyers. It is conventional now for big businesses and big law firms to talk about human rights, for good or ill. Perhaps that familiarity with human rights has helped to breed a spirit, unfortunate though it is, at least of disillusionment among some of the public. In those circumstances, it is more important than ever that we all help to contribute to an informed and positive debate about human rights and the impact they have on people's lives and our society. At Hogan Lovells, our commitment to human rights is not just about our pro bono and citizenship work. Substantial though that is, whether it is individual cases of rights abused in this country or international issues of policy, whether in North Korea or sub-Saharan Africa. It is not just about that, because human rights also matter for our commercial clients. They matter for commercial clients because increasingly human rights is the international framework within which big businesses, NGOs, and governments have to operate together and operate in ways that affect individuals. They are a protection and a constraint for all of us who have an impact on the lives of others. And it is important that businesses, as well as lawyers, contribute to that positive and informed debate. That is why we have sought to encourage our clients to participate in these sorts of issues alongside us. Helena Kennedy's pedigree in human rights is second to none and will be well known to you all. I do not envy Martha the forensic grilling that I'm sure she is about to receive, but I have no doubt that the end result of it will be a further contribution to a well-informed and positive debate. Oh. Thank you both very much for being here. Thank you everybody else for making the time to come.
Well, Charles, thank you for hosting us here at this great law firm. It's very nice to be in your premises, and your welcome has been really great. And I want to say thank you to Eva for telling you a bit about the Human Rights Lawyers Association, because it really is important that that all lawyers should be thinking of themselves as human rights lawyers in our contemporary world. It doesn't matter which field of law. People always come to me and say, I want to be a human rights lawyer, and how can I become one? And I say, look, you have to, you know, I was a criminal lawyer. There are people who are employment lawyers. There are people who are working in many different environmental lawyers. And in working in different fields, you bring the values of human rights to what you're doing. And indeed, today, as you've just heard Charles saying, no commercial lawyer worth his salt who's doing well by his clients is going to, or her clients, is going to be able to resist knowing about human rights and the ways in which everyone has to be mindful of what those values are about. I'm going to disappoint you, because I'm not going to inflict cruel and inhumane treatment on Martha Spurrier, but I am. I'm hoping that this will be a conversation rather than an interrogation. It is a great pleasure for me to be here today to do this, because what was I doing just a few hours ago? Well, there in the House of Lords, I was dressed up in ermine, not conducive on a day like today, but I was wearing it. We don't always, but I was wearing it because I was one of the introducers of Shami Chakrabarti into the House of Lords. And it really was a great moment to see someone who's, you know, been the, you know, precursor of Martha championing civil liberties and human rights for all these years, and now taking her place in this part of Parliament where she will continue to have a voice. And Martha, I'm looking forward to in 10 years' time that you will join them there, but maybe it will be a reformed House of Lords by that time. Is that wishful thinking? Anyway, I really wanted to start, Martha, by asking you, the big boots that you're stepping into. What is the 5-year plan for liberty? We've got a government that doesn't look as though it's likely to call an election anytime soon, and the commitment is to 5 years, and so we're a year in, and it looks as though we've got 4 more years of Conservative government. And I just wondered, what is liberty sort of seeing as being the things that are kind of on a list, your checklist of what you see is coming down the turnpike and that you're going to be crashing into in the next years. What are the big priorities for Liberty in this next period?
Well, it feels like it could be a very long list indeed, and I think one of the challenges is to be strategic and focused in the things that we choose to do. I think there's two ways that I think about Liberty's next 5 years and the staff, the team at Liberty as well. The first is inevitably being reactive, because of course that's a big part of what Liberty does. So we will respond to what the government does, and that is going to be more important than ever for as long as we have a fairly fractured opposition who may not be as strong and united on these issues as we would sometimes like. It is more important when we are having conversations about our national identity, which will also involve conversations about Scotland and Northern Ireland and Wales. And that the purpose of Liberty in those conversations will be constantly to push a progressive legislative landscape, constantly to defend human rights protections. And of course, within that, there are going to be specific challenges. Now, we know, for example, that the potential repeal of the Human Rights Act is very much still on the table. It was in the Conservative manifesto in 2015. Theresa May has committed to delivering on the manifesto pledges. And those of you may have seen Liz Truss, the new Justice Secretary, give evidence last week where she said that, yes, indeed, repeal was still very much on her agenda. That has to be a major priority for Liberty. It has to be a major priority for everyone in this room and everyone who cares about human rights, large and small. And in 5 years, or in 4 years, when the next general election is called, I would very much hope that no party of any colour would even dream of suggesting that we should ever consider repealing our Human Rights Act. So that's going to be a major focus of our work. We also know that in the pipeline is likely to be the counter-extremism bill, which, if and when it is published, and we think that might happen sometime next year, is likely to be extraordinarily controversial on issues including free speech and freedom of belief. And it will be a real priority of Liberty's to create very broad, very vocal coalitions to come together, again, from across the political spectrum and also from across the communities in the UK, to speak out against what purports to be a radical departure from previous criminal and civil provisions which target activity which is violent, and move into an attempt to target activity which is non-violent, non-violent extremism. And so a move towards what is appears to be an Orwellian attempt to police thought and to police conversation. At the moment, of course, we have the final stages of the Investigatory Powers Bill. That really is in its last legs at the moment, and we have seen sweeping powers of surveillance go through Parliament over the last few months. Almost certainly that bill will come into force as it is now, perhaps with a few of the edges knocked off. And the next 5 years, Liberty will have to focus again with its partners in its work, like Privacy International, on trying to make sure that what is now going to be the most intrusive and invasive surveillance regime in the world, trying to make sure that that regime, through the courts, is turned into something that resembles some kind of human rights compliant regime. Of course, then there's also Brexit. I don't know if we're 5 minutes through the conversation before.
Oh, I'm going to stop you before you go on to this, because, I mean, can we really use an expression like the most intrusive surveillance regime in the world when we know there are places like North Korea, and when we know that Putin's no pussycat when it comes to the surveillance and intrusion into the privacy of people's lives? I mean, isn't it dangerous to overstate those things?
I think the surveillance regime introduced by the Investigatory Powers Bill will be the most intrusive legalised regime in the world. Now, we know that authoritarian dictatorial powers intrude on their citizens' lives in horrendous ways every day. Most of those leaders do not have a statutory footing for what they're doing. They don't have a statutory footing for a lot of what they're doing, and they don't have any regard for what their parliaments would like them to do or like them to stop doing. The point is that in this country, we do not hand over to our executive and to those who have a monopoly over coercion and control all of our private information and all of our data. And it is absolutely right to say that the powers, particularly the bulk powers in this bill, are unprecedented. For example, in America, the bulk hacking powers that the Investigatory Powers Bill contains have been struck down. I'll give you an example of what the bulk hacking powers means, because I do think there is a problem with this bill. It is a faceless, technology-driven bill, and it's very hard to understand the human implications. Hacking is when a member of the security services or a police officer can go into one of your devices, untracked, and can alter the content on your device. No audit trail. You don't know that your phone contains a text message that you never wrote, that you never sent, or a blog post, or a WhatsApp message. Now, you may think the innocent have nothing to fear and nothing to hide, but in the last year, and I would hope longer than that, we have been given very good reason to be sceptical about those who do have a monopoly over coercion and over control, and the way that they use their power. And I don't mean that in a way that is conspiracy theories, and I don't mean that there are people who are out to get us, but what I mean is that these institutions can be self-corrupting, and they have to be transparent, and they have to be accountable. This year, we have seen the Hillsborough result. That is the most salient example of why it is important for the police to be policed. As we all know, central to the Hillsborough disaster was the cover-up that happened afterwards. And what that cover-up did was police officers writing witness statements saying that fans were drunk and were to blame for the deaths of their loved ones. Now, just imagine if those police officers had hacking powers. Just imagine the police officers hacking into the fans' phones and writing text messages and altering the content and tweaking the photographs to make it look like, sure enough, those fans were drunk. Those fans did have an intention to turn up with cans and cans of lager and to rush the gates. Just when you think about these powers being used in the wrong way, which of course they may well be, because powers usually are sometimes used in the wrong way, then you realise the full chilling effect of this regime. And I stand by it. It is intrusive, it is invasive, it's unprecedented. And at the moment, the safeguards that are included in the bill will go no way to providing proper human rights protections.
Well, that was great. That was very good. that would pass the John Humphreys test. I'm afraid that's what you've got. Life waits for you in the Today studio. You're looking forward to it. Anyway, it was one of the things I wanted to ask you about, was the whole business of surveillance and those powers. Because, of course, what you're thrown at you all the time is that you have to, in the end, trust authorities, because how else are we going to deal with something like terrorism? And somehow people always imagine that these things are in the past. Abuses live in the past. They do not live in the present. That's how people imagine it. So I just wanted to ask you about that, about your hinterland, in a way, Martha. You are a member of my chambers, or you, and we still think of you as one of us, but you are a member of Doughty Street Chambers. But where did you come from? What made Martha Spurrier, what was your journey into this world of law and human rights?
Well, I'm not a person who wanted to be a barrister since I was 10. I don't think I really knew any lawyers. The law wasn't something that featured in my imagination when I was doing my degree. I studied history, not law. But when I was studying, there were two things that really turned my head. One was political theory, and within that, the theory of human rights and also feminism. And the other was doing plays. And what I loved about doing plays was the coming together of lots of different people with lots of different skills and doing something creative and interesting and thought-provoking. And within that, I grew up in London and I was always a great fan of political theatre, a long-time lover of The Tricycle, did all those verbatim plays, very taken with the idea of how you engage people in issues that otherwise can seem very academic and theoretical. I left university with not a clue about what to do, moved home. Volunteered for a while at my local prison, which was Wormwood Scrubs, and the cogs in my brain started to turn quite slowly about all the theory that I'd been reading about, and these ideas about human rights, these ideas about these closed worlds where there's no scrutiny and no accountability. When I was volunteering at Wormwood Scrubs, the issues that I was trying to help people with weren't glamorous. They were things like people's laundry going missing or people's phone cards not working. They couldn't call their families. But if you haven't ever been into a prison and you get the chance to visit, not to commit a crime, I found it to be a uniquely soul-destroying place in many ways. Prisons are holding places for people whose lives are so much more complicated than the one thing that got them into prison. And you see in that environment why it is so important that the people who govern their every move, every minute of the day, do that scrupulously fairly and treat them with scrupulous equality. And so that's when the dots were joined in my mind, really, the sense that actually all this theory and the stuff I'd read in books and enjoyed talking about and listening to lectures about had real implications for people's lives. And then I started to learn about lawyers and people who did prison law and thought that that seemed like an interesting place to try and go, a place to use my skills to help people who weren't always able to advocate for themselves. And so that's why I went to the bar. But I think I always had a part of me that missed the teamwork that happened when you did a play and that missed maybe some of the creativity that you get from being immersed in wider issues. And so when the Liberty job came up, I was very taken with the idea that you could be part of a team, all pulling in the same direction, all bringing to bear their different skills, and that that might be a slightly more diverse platform from which to try and advocate for the same kinds of rights that I've been talking about when I've been doing parole board hearings for the last 5 years.
Because you have a large part of your practice was around the business of prison and
yes.
And prisoners' rights. And of course, certainly I've known about your work around the recent changes to legal aid and
yes.
problems around prisoners' opportunities for taking cases based because of the absence of legal aid, but based on their experiences and the ways in which their rights are being overrun. Martha, I mean, it's quite a big move. I mean, in if you think about it, in terms of being a practitioner who's going into court, making the arguments, you're part of a collegiate thing, but you're very much the nature of the bar is that you're your own boss and you can make your decisions without too much reference mm-hmm. to other people, mm-hmm. except when you're actually doing a case. But are you already getting a sense that it's going to be very different?
Definitely. I mean, the issues are the same. So you still get the same fire in your belly when you're reading about the government's latest proposal to do X as you do when you read the papers of your parole board hearing. So I think the passion, whether you're a human rights lawyer or campaigner or policymaker, comes from the same source. But it's different in myriad ways. I don't have control over my diary, although I have to say that's a bit of an illusion because I worked 7 days a week at the bar and didn't ever feel like I was much in control. But to me, the best thing and the thing that was a lovely revelation to me has been the teamwork. Being part of this team of people who are so committed, who I see every day, not just while I'm doing a case with them, to be able to build these relationships and develop our plans over time is very exhilarating. I find that to be a very energising part of my new job.
I wanted to ask about the way in which strategies work when you're a campaigner rather than someone who's a practitioner. I would have thought that being there in at Liberty, one of the first things you're going to have to do is find out where you've got allies in government, how can you make friends and influence mm-hmm. people, and you know, have you been doing the rounds and leaving your calling card with certain people?
Yes, very much so. I mean, the benefit of being new somewhere is that it gives you a very good reason to pick up the phone and ask for a meeting. It gives you a very good reason to ask what people think about Liberty and to hear their views on what we do, what we could be doing better, which I find very valuable and also I hope reflects the fact that we are an organisation that's open to collaborating with lots of different people. And Liberty is, by its constitution, a cross-party, non-party organisation, and that has served it very, very well, of course. And we have very good friends on all sides of the political spectrum, which is very valuable. I'm really pleased to say that we have very good relationships with members of the Conservative Party. I think that will stand us in very good stead for when we, going forward, need to advocate for good human rights protections. But it's not just in Parliament. You know, I've been meeting with people from faith groups, I've been meeting with trades unions, I've been meeting with teachers and other public servants, I'm hoping to meet with the Police Federation. I think it's about saying actually these issues can draw on a very, very broad coalition indeed, and there will be things that we disagree on, but where we agree, let's all go on the front foot and stand up for what we believe in.
Have you yet had a chance to meet with either our new Home Secretary or our new Justice Secretary of State?
No, I have written to both of them and they have so far declined my generous offer to meet with them.
Because I would have thought that it's going to be quite interesting to find out just where they stand on this. You must have done a little recce on this.
Yeah.
And sort of looked to see, has anybody ever said, has Miss Rudd ever uttered something on the subject of civil liberties or anything, has she?
Basically, no.
No?
Both Amber Rudd and Liz Truss are fairly unknown quantities in terms of...
We call them clean skins if you work with the intelligence services. So they come clean to this whole issue.
Yes, they come clean, which is, I think, probably good and bad. I think I just always hope with anyone who's making decisions that they're willing to listen. I respect people who will change their mind, and so I hope in due course, when there are controversial things that they want to do, I hope they'll take meetings with Liberty and with everybody else.
Yeah. What about, you were talking about the problem of the opposition being in such disarray, and that opposition being beyond the Labour Party, which has got its own disarray, but the Liberal Democrats are kind of almost non-existent in the Commons, in great numbers in the House of Lords. Who are your allies there? Have you been dropping your card into their post bags too?
Absolutely. I mean, I think no matter who is in government, the opposition is always going to be vitally important for Liberty, for any campaigning organisation, because it's how you hold people to account. It's how you make sure you have proper parliamentary scrutiny. So, yes, I've met with people from every single political party. I think that's right. I was up in Scotland last week meeting with Nicola Sturgeon, Kezia Dugdale and Adam Tompkins, so from all the main parties up there. And again, I think what I've been trying to impress upon everybody is where there are issues where we have something in common, whether we agree or disagree, let's at least have a constructive conversation. And where people are in opposition, let's hold people in power to account, no matter who they are. So the SNP are fantastically good on some human rights issues, but they're not perfect. And they need to be held to account just as much as the Conservative government does here in Westminster.
I mean, it is, the older you get, the more you realise this, is that, folk are terribly good on civil liberties when they're in opposition, but it's a whole different ballpark once power gets into their hands. And there's that old saying about power being delightful and absolute power being absolutely delightful. I just wondered whether, particularly around this business of repealing the Human Rights Act, isn't the whole Brexit discussion going to put a very different complexion on that?
Yes, I think almost certainly it will. My money was on the Human Rights Act being repealed very aggressively and swiftly if there had been a narrow Remain vote. I think the fact that there's been a vote to leave means two things for the Human Rights Act. It firstly means that the government is very, very busy dealing with Brexit, and connected to that, it means that the government is, I would have thought, less likely to want to have another big fight about something very, very principled that is connected, in people's minds at least, to something that's European. We also think, in Liberty, that the fight in Westminster would be very difficult indeed. We don't think that they have the numbers in the Commons because, of course, much as this government are currently acting with supreme confidence as though they won a landslide, they have a tiny majority in the House of Commons, and I don't think that repeal of the HRA would get through the House of Lords. So the future, in many ways, the HRA is optimistic in that sense. I mean, I don't think that should ever allow for complacency because I think this is an act that looks set to come under attack again and again. Where I think we may get into very dangerous territory is if during the Brexit negotiations, Theresa May or David Davis or whoever is doing them is forced to make a concession which is very unpopular with the right wing of the party. Because at that point, the HRA is the red meat, and it would have been the red meat had Remain won. And I think it might be the red meat, for example, if a deal is done on immigration, which the right wing of the party are very dissatisfied with, I can see that the HRA might get thrown in their direction and that things might get quite scary if that happens.
The only thing I would say to you about that is that I chair the subcommittee, the Justice Subcommittee for the European Union Select Committee, in the House of Lords. And we review all sorts of things to do with law, and we've embarked upon an inquiry. Today was our first day into acquired rights. So people might understand, might not be particularly familiar with this, is that one of the big questions, and not a week goes by in Parliament without somebody in the back benches and then reiteration by others about the concerns that they have from friends that they have who now live in this country, who are from Germany or from France or bankers in the city or whatever, and they're all alarmed about what their position is going to be, and can any reassurance and comfort be given to them as to what their rights are going to be, and whether they're going to miss out on things. And one of the things that was very interesting in taking evidence today was that we keep hearing that that of course people need not worry, and yet that's not being spelt out. So as I say, the questions are asked constantly in Parliament, in the Commons, and in the Lords. And today we had two really distinguished lawyers giving evidence to us, who one an international public lawyer and the other a European Union expert, law expert. And both of them were very clear that there's no comfort in international law. I mean, it's minimal. And one of the problems for international law is that, unlike the European Convention on Human Rights, you haven't got direct access as an individual citizen or as an individual non-citizen, but somebody who's living in a country and has done for 10 years, and you have set up a small business because you design clothes or something, your children are going to school and you're looking at the possibility of whether what their schooling might be for the secondary level. You have got pension rights that might be located here. And so you want to know what your situation is. And the truth is, the European Convention on Human Rights provides greater comfort than, even sort of, there's a protocol Article 1 of Protocol 1, which is about, property rights, gives you the kind of comfort that people often who've got business interests here and so on really want. What's going to happen to your small factory that you now have created? And so, actually, there's going to become a call from quite unusual bits of our society around the need for the European Convention on Human Rights to remain, because it is going to give the protections that are not going to be afforded in other areas. And so, in this run-up, it's going to be part of the bargaining, of course, in the negotiation. But there are far more. I mean, the talk, of course, is around the political and civil rights and around property rights. But I mean, there are all those other things like pensions, like people's concern about access to healthcare. Is Britain? I mean, you'll see it in the Guardian tomorrow, because I've already seen a little thing come through on my phone about what's appeared online in the Guardian online about this evidence session. And I think that we're going to find that the European Convention on Human Rights is going to be a ballast that many people who were not previously very interested in convention rights will now see as being rather important to preserve in this Brexit situation. Because people who voted for Brexit are getting up in the House and saying, we've got to protect people who've lived here and who are concerned about their futures and what the future holds for them. So I think that we may find that things develop in ways that are surprising to us. Can I just move us on to talking about some of the things that are really pressing? I mean, one of the things that is very much on the agenda of most of us who work in this field is the absence of legal aid, the way in which legal aid has been so diminished, and yet it being fundamental to the rule of law and to the whole access to justice issue. What are the plans is there no going back? Are we going to be crowdsourcing every case that matters? I mean, what's the future there?
Well, I mean, the first thing to say is that access to justice has long been and will continue to be a priority of Liberties. As you've alluded to, when I was at the bar, I did a number of cases challenging the cuts to legal aid with varying degrees of success. I think the greatest success in the last year has to be defeating the residence test, which was such a horrendously discriminatory and insidious policy. Do I feel hopeful that legal aid will be returned to its former glory? No. I think that the way to tackle the access to justice problem is to be diligent in collecting evidence of how broken the system now is, how much it therefore costs, because problems that start small and that could be resolved quickly by 20 minutes of legal advice about a family law problem or a debt problem or a housing problem are left to escalate and to cluster with other problems until a person has a mammoth and debilitating legal problem that there is then no legal aid for any lawyer to help them with, that then they go before a very, very well-paid judge and the judge has to spend a day sifting through their Tesco bag full of papers to try and get to the bottom of whatever injustice started right at the beginning when it was very, very small and that has had then devastating impacts on this person's life and probably their family's life. So I think there is a piece of work to be done, which everyone is responsible for, in identifying the hidden effects of the cuts to legal aid and the fact that access to justice is not just about being able to turn up to court on your own and have a conversation about a judge. I don't feel optimistic that this government are going to inject money into the legal aid budget, because by definition, the people who are deprived of legal aid tend to be, firstly, not people who vote Conservative, but more importantly, people that are disenfranchised in other ways. And prisoners is a prime example of that. If you remove legal aid from prisoners, not very many people care about that, and prisoners can't really say anything very effectively about it. And so it is a hidden injustice, which it's very hard to demonstrate. I'm always a great fan of trying to put the human stories on these injustices because they are too big for people to understand and the numbers are too big for people to understand. But actually, I think if you can get the stories out there, if you can tell the stories of these families, these prisoners, these people who get into housing difficulties, if you can explain that they are ordinary people who have got into ordinary problems and then have suddenly found those problems to escalate in a way that they never imagined and find themselves desperate and out of control, if you can get that across, then I think the tide of public opinion might start to shift back to the idea that actually our good legal system and what once was a healthy legal aid system is something to be really proud of and is something to understand that that's a fundamental part of the checks and balances of any democratic society.
Clearly the whole business of taking cases is part of the business of all of us, but I was just wondering about the role that Liberty has played in sort of joining into actions, or the big ones on like the torture stuff and the unlawful detentions and so on, in playing a role as an amicus to the court, mm-hmm. and so on in some of those major cases. Do you see that as being part of the work that you will be particularly interested in?
Yes, definitely. So I think interventions are important now, but they're going to be increasingly important in identifying the broader policy and systemic issues that individual cases that happen to manage to get to court raise. And Liberty is very well placed, as are other organisations, to draw to the court's attention the really serious issues that the judges need to be aware of when they're making a decision. So as to say to those judges, this is not about this one individual who you may like or you may dislike. This actually has ramifications for people across the board and for the rule of law and for human rights. So yes, that will continue to be a really major plank of Liberty's work. I think also there is a role for Liberty in challenging some of these difficult issues head on. I did a lot of work when I was at the bar on immigration detention. It's an issue that I feel very passionately about. I'm against it. I don't feel passionately about immigration detention as a thing. As you will all know, we are the only country in Europe that indefinitely detains our immigrants for administrative convenience only. I don't think that a lot of people know that.
They don't.
And there have been many cases, some more successful than others, which have shown that detainees in immigration removal centres are treated appallingly. 6 cases in the last 5 years where there has been a finding of an Article 3 breach, so a finding of an inhuman and degrading treatment in a first world country, in the UK, 6 findings. And through the courts, we have got so far. We've got those findings. There have been findings about how it's wrong to detain pregnant women, how it's wrong to detain the mentally ill, how it's wrong to detain children. I think it's a thorny issue. I think people are nervous about going near issues that are about immigrants. And I think organisations like Liberty have an obligation to stand up and say that this is an absolute stain on this country's human rights record, and that no one should tolerate this, and that the taxpayers and the citizens who voted for this government did not vote them in to give them licence to detain people indefinitely, that this government does not have the country's permission to continue with that kind of practice.
Oh, I'd be cheering if I was in the Any Questions audience. I mean, one of the other things that I feel, you know, just as enraged about is the whole business of the spread of secret courts.
Yeah.
Because that's where, you know, my court work takes me these days, there's no reporting, no whatever, because the evidence is so often presented in my absence, and we're seeing that spreading. I mean, it started, you'll remember, around terrorism and around the whole business of having to hear intelligence in the absence of the defendant, and as their lawyers, and given us the relationship of counsel, we would be removed from the court. But it's now moved from the criminal, you know, from those often deportation, immigration cases, or criminal cases, into civil cases, where those who were in Guantanamo were wanting to bring cases. The whole business of rendition has been closed off behind closed doors. I mean, it's sort of catching. Is it going to continue to be a battle? Do you think we're going to see even more of it?
Yes, I think we will. I mean, I think, like so many of these things, it's a slow creep, and that's why the first fight is always so important. Because if you lose that, and if people think that first incremental step into civil liberties is okay, then what you're really doing is licensing then mission creep. And I think we've absolutely seen mission creep with secret courts. I mean, you have the power to hold hearings in secret in the Information Tribunal now. And so I did a case just before I joined Liberty in which a immigration detainee had been shackled while he was dying in hospital. And we only knew that this had happened because there was one line in an inspectorate report saying that there had been two cases of detainees being shackled while they were dying in hospital. And we only knew of one case, and there'd been a Prison and Probation Ombudsman report, very critical report into this case, and there'd been an inquest under the Human Rights Act investigating what had happened. And there had been very, very critical findings and very, very critical coverage in the press. So we thought, well, that's strange. We only knew of one case. So we did an FOI request. And we said, well, what's this second case? Can you tell us about it? And they said, no, we're not obliged to tell you anything about that case under the Freedom of Information Act. And that's because at the time that he died, we had lifted our detention powers. We lifted the powers 5 hours before he died. So there was no prison and probation.
He wasn't detained at the time
that he
died.
So he wasn't detained at the time that he died. And that meant there had been no full inquest into his death. The coroner didn't even know that this man had been shackled just before he died. And there had been no Prison and Probation Ombudsman report, so no independent scrutiny at all of what had happened. And the Home Office said, we're not telling you anything about it. We will tell you that we've done our own internal report, but we're not disclosing it. And we had to fight them all the way to the Information Tribunal to get disclosure of that report. And in the Information Tribunal, the Home Office made a very robust application, supported by the Information Commissioner, to have a hearing in secret so that they could explain to the tribunal why it was that the contents of this report shouldn't be disclosed. And the shocking thing was that the exemption, I mean, this sounds kind of nerdily lawyery, but it's really shocking. The exemption that they were relying on, that the Home Office was relying on, is that disclosure of the report would cause shock and emotional trauma to the family members of the man who had been shackled. So it was so bad.
It's for the protection of his own folk.
So it was so, the way he had been treated by the state was so bad that his family would be damaged if they knew about it. And the Home Office, like I say, supported by the Information Commissioner, stood up in court about 6 months ago and tried to refuse with giving a report.
Please
on that
tell
basis.
Me you won.
Yeah, we won eventually, you know. But that's the kind of That's the culture. That's the level of shutting down that they even think it's acceptable. So, I mean, these were barristers. These were good barristers running these arguments. These were senior people in the Home Office signing witness statements saying we will not be disclosing this report. And that shows you that's the culture that secret courts has given rise to. It is a culture of trying to shut things down and to not have scrutiny. And in its worst case, it becomes a deeply paternalistic culture because it then tries to justify itself by saying it's just better that you don't know. And I think, frankly, we are beyond the time when we just trust what our politicians and our Home Office officials are doing. We do want to know, and we do want to see, and we do want to hold them to account.
Martha, there's another of those areas which, I mean, you know, some of this stuff we have to remember so that, for people who are of different political complexions in our audience, a lot of this stuff started under the new Labour government. Yeah. And then, of course, we've seen it becoming part and parcel of legal regimes. I mean, one of the things that I wanted to ask you about was how enthusiastic you are about victims' law, because I understand that, for example, our former Director of Public Prosecutions has got a bill, a victims' law bill, that he's going to be pushing. And I have to tell you that having been a champion of victims' rights for more years than I can count, and we're talking about decades, probably older than most of you are, but one of the things that always concerns me is that trying to do stuff for victims was really used by governments in order to diminish defendants' rights. And so, I'm always leery when I hear people talking about improving victims' rights, because I always think you can be sure that this is going to be some way in which we're going to have less rights for those who are standing trial. Have you had a look at this bill, and what do you think of it?
I haven't seen the bill. I agree that whenever you're talking about one group of people's rights, you have to be very careful to make sure that in the small print is not the taking away of an equal and opposite group of people's rights. And that goes for victims and defendants just as much as it goes for migrants and British citizens or prisoners and people who are at liberty. So I think that bill will have to be given a kind of very fine reading to make sure it doesn't have those implications. But I do think that there is merit in the victims' rights agenda, because, of course, participation in court proceedings, participation in prosecutorial decisions, I think is really important. I think it's particularly important in areas such as rape, where we have seen such terrible statistics about charging and then effectively prosecuting sexual offences. And so I think there is definitely room for that agenda, and it can be a very, very positive one and very much in line with a broader rights agenda. But absolutely, it should enshrine within it the Article 6 rights of criminal defendants.
One of the things that has come out of Europe recently is a directive on victims' rights, which may, disappear down the Swanee if Brexit really takes hold. And so it makes perhaps the argument for there being a bill the more important. And it's hard to imagine why a Conservative government wouldn't support such a bill, unless, of course, they see it as a way of reducing defendants' rights. It is something that where you could get common cause, and it's something that Liberty, for example, might be a good broker on. particularly around the issue of women's rights,
yes.
Because particularly around sexual offending and abuse against of women and so on, there's still serious problems in this country. And it seems to me that it is one of those things that should be championed. I wanted to ask you about Brexit. Is Liberty actually, sitting down and having some sort of think tanky stuff done on Brexit? I mean, presumably, your position is neutral on whether we stay in or come out.
Yes.
But you're going to be alert to ways in which it might involve the reduction of rights.
Exactly, yeah. So we were neutral on the outcome of the referendum, remain neutral, and our only agenda is, as with everything, that as the Brexit negotiations unfold, that they do not involve the lessening of any rights protection for UK citizens or migrants that are here. Now, My view is that most people who voted to leave the European Union didn't do so on the basis that they thought it would weaken workers' rights, for example. I don't think they did so on the basis that it would mean that the regulation preventing the UK from exporting equipment that might be used for the purposes of torture would be repealed. So I think that there should be mileage in going to the government and saying there are red lines here. You have to protect people's rights. You don't have a mandate for lessening rights protections. And so either commit to these things not being on the table, or if you are going to put them on the table, then bring it before Parliament and have an honest, proper democratic process with full scrutiny from in both houses about what those kind of rights lessening would look like.
It's interesting, though, because one of the things we're hearing is that there's to be no running commentary and therefore interacting with whoever is going to be leading up the negotiations is quite difficult. Mm-hmm. So do you think that you will be given a hearing on those issues?
Well,
I mean, David Davis is somebody who carries the Secretary of State for Brexit hat now, but he's been a friend to civil liberties and to liberty.
Yeah.
And so you would probably have his door open.
Yes, I think David Davis's door is very much open, and he has assured Liberty, since assuming his position in the cabinet, that he is committed still to the Human Rights Act and that he doesn't see the Brexit process as a way of weakening rights protections. I don't think that should let us be complacent, and I do think that there is a very real risk that this process will not have full parliamentary scrutiny, and certainly Liberty and I'm sure many, many others will be advocating and lobbying for there to be transparency. I mean, running commentary, maybe not, that might be too much, but I think on big decisions that are being made and positions being taken, it must be right to maintain a healthy constitutional democracy that those issues are aired publicly and in Parliament.
It seems to me that there's been a sort of strange thing that's happened. In the sort of last minutes before the referendum, Theresa May said that she'd changed her mind on our leaving the European Convention on Human Rights, which had been her position. She was so pissed off with the whole business of sending Abu Qatada back to Syria and the humiliations involved in that. At the hands of Doughty Street Chambers, I want to boast. She seemed to change her mind at the last minute. Mm-hmm. So we have a Prime Minister who certainly has said that. We have David Davis, the Brexit man, saying no, he's committed to the Human Rights Act. It did come as a surprise to me that we suddenly had this little business from our new Justice Secretary suggesting that she was still... where is that coming from?
Well, I mean, you can speculate about where politicians dream things up.
Do you think it's just that the civil servants in the Justice Department have got used to saying we're going to get rid of the Human Rights Act, and therefore she's getting the same kind of guff put across her table?
I mean, I think, realistically, it is in the manifesto. Theresa May has said she's going to deliver on the manifesto pledges. That's the only thing you can say when you are not an elected Prime Minister. And so when on the Today programme or in Justice Questions, Liz Truss is asked directly about whether she's going to deliver on a manifesto pledge, I think it's fanciful to think she would publicly climb down, because where is the political mileage in that? So instead she will say and continue to say, yes, of course we'll deliver on the manifesto pledge and we want to repeal the Human Rights Act. And there's enough support in the party and there's enough support in the voters that that's a good thing. It doesn't lose them any traction. Whether that then translates into some concrete action, I don't know. I suspect there will be a consultation. I think a consultation is a very good way to keep everyone very busy with their heads down, tearing apart all the different proposals, and to then say we're thinking very hard about all the consultation responses and effectively to kick it into the long grass. And that, I think, is a real threat for the third sector, because this has been a phony war now for 6 years. And what it has meant is that a lot of people have been very afraid to campaign on issues that might then rebound on the Human Rights Act debate. So they have been afraid to talk about prisoners' rights. They have been afraid to talk about immigrants' rights, and instead have tried to push the more acceptable face of human rights. Now that's really important.
You've old ladies in care homes.
Old ladies in care homes. Now that is right. That is a face of human rights. So you've got to get those stories out there. And it's an incredibly important part of everyone's responsibility to campaign for the Human Rights Act is to say it helps ordinary families up and down the country every day. But there are hard edges to human rights. And the danger is that by continuing this phony war, the government just holds the NGO sector at the status quo. Because you cannot imagine how there has been planning blight. People become unambitious when they worry that the most important thing is going to be taken away from them. And so I think, although we have to keep defending it, and we have to keep being loud, and we have to keep telling the positive stories, we also have to say we're going to go on the front foot and we're going to push for proper human rights protections in areas that we have been nervous about talking about. And that's something I really hope that Liberty will do going forward. Positive obligations, immigration detention, migrants' rights, prisoners. These are all issues that if you believe in human rights, you can understand that the hard edges will always be there. And I think that people get that. I think if you explain to people that there will always be cases that you don't agree with, but that fundamentally you buy into the scheme because it is important that your executive is held to account by independent judges, and that you shouldn't throw out a whole scheme just because there's one case or two cases that you disagree with. I think people understand that. I think people are empathetic and compassionate enough to understand the old adage that we are only as civilised as how we treat our prisoners, and we are only as civilised as how we treat our detainees. And on an individual level, people understand it. And I think we have to be brave enough to engage on that level. I think we have to be brave enough to address the hard issues as well as the easy ones.
That was really, really important. I mean, I haven't heard anyone talking about that problem, which is really true, which is that people have felt silenced. And what they've had to do, all the organisations dealing with human rights, is, you know, run round themselves ragged finding cases that will speak to the lives of Middle England and not talk about the tough stuff that most of us spend our lives doing. Anyway, I want to just finally, before taking this to the audience, to say, you know, what's the downside of the job? It sounds rather fun, and it sounds as though you're excited about it. But I mean, what you know, is it the Today programme? Is it John Humphreys? Is it the On Question Time?
I haven't had to do the John Humphreys or the Question Time thing yet. It may well be that those become the downside when I do them. I am having a great time. It's an opportunity to talk about things that I feel very strongly about with people who will listen and will think about it, you hope, and you might get to influence their decisions. So broadly speaking, it's been I've only been in the job for 3 months, but it's been a fantastic 3 months. I think there are two potential downsides. One is that as a young woman, I have had a number of meetings with older men who love to tell me about how human rights work. I mean, and I won't name names, but there are some politicians who have me in for a meeting and then step by step tell me about this Human Rights Act that we have and this way that it works. And
he's not called Lord Leicester by any chance, is he?
So mansplaining has definitely been a feature of some of my meetings, which has been a shame. And I think the other downside is that I'm on Twitter. I said something about spit hoods recently. I think spit hoods are a really disproportionate tool for the police to use. I personally have done a number of cases concerning them. They are these full head and face hoods.
Yeah.
They're very shocking to see. If you Google image it, it's quite stark. An extraordinary tool for the police to have recourse to when they already have recourse to a whole array of means of restraining suspects. And the Met Police, under the radar, without any public announcement, decided to bring in spit hoods. No consultation, no equality impact assessment to work out whether they impact more on kids or on people with mental health problems. And they were going to bring them in only in custody suites, so completely outside of the scrutiny of the press or the public. So I made a pretty robust comment about it, because I think it's pretty outrageous and I think people should really care and should stand up and listen. And what followed was an absolute torrent of abuse, which I'm sure should have been expected on Twitter, about how I deserve to be spat at. And, you know, it's not the most like nuanced, high-level conversation, and you've only got 140 characters, it's quite hard to engage. But I think that is a downside, because the sort of social media world, which is important to engage with, when you're a membership organisation in particular, it can be an echo chamber of people who just want to have a go at you. And being a lawyer is in many ways a wonderfully anonymous thing because it's your clients that are important, it's your client's case. And I think I'm getting used to the idea of people not liking what I'm saying and then feeling like they can just have a go at me. And I'm sure I'll develop a thicker skin, but every now and again I just do feel a bit sad about it.
And we know it's particularly hard for women. Anyway, listen, I think it sounds as though you're going to make a real fist of this.
Thanks.
And our excitement when you were appointed is well justified, so I'm really thrilled for you, Martha. This is an opportunity to open it up and let the audience come and ask you some other questions. There's two microphones out there that my friends there are going to run up and down the steps with. So who would like to ask Martha a question? There's a gentleman up there towards the back. Can we get round to him with the gentleman in the middle with the blue shirt?
Hi, Martha. My question is, what's the strongest argument you've heard for the repeal of the Human Rights Act? And why, in your mind, is that still not a sufficient reason to repeal it?
Well, I haven't heard any arguments that I've found in any way persuasive. I think that an argument that gets made by some conservative politicians in particular, many of whom have academic backgrounds, that the problem with the Human Rights Act is that it in some way tampers with parliamentary sovereignty. Now, of course, it doesn't tamper with parliamentary sovereignty because we don't have strike down powers, so Parliament can always legislate to overrule the Supreme Court. The power of that argument is that there are politicians, and of course, I often think it's no coincidence that politicians love parliamentary sovereignty because of the absolute power being absolutely delightful problem. But I think that argument can appeal to some academically minded conservative politicians because they think that parliamentary sovereignty is one of the great traditions of this country and that there is a danger that activist judges are going to come and introduce judge-made law which is not democratic. I think, firstly, constitutionally that's wrong as an argument. But I also think, and I try and say this when I meet some of these politicians, that it's incredibly dangerous to have an argument which is fundamentally about protecting vulnerable people from state abuses of power in a purely theoretical and academic way. It can sound very like often a bunch of old white men who enjoy having conversations as though they are still having an Oxford or Cambridge supervision about how our democratic settlement should operate, forgetting that in fact you are talking about heavy-handed policing, or you are talking about undignified healthcare, or you are talking about people being locked up and not being given treatment for mental illness. And so I think it's a pernicious argument, not just because it's wrong, but because it distracts from the fact that human rights isn't about fine constitutional arguments. It is about keeping the state within the four corners of its power.
Thank you.
There's a hand just there, so it's so easy. Just please give that woman a microphone.
Yeah, lucky I sat here then.
Yeah.
My name's Maria Manir. I guess I'm a human rights activist, just like the rest of us. That's why I'm here, specialising in gender rights activism. You talked earlier about, you know, being a feminist and mansplaining torrents of abuse on Twitter, something I completely identify with. And as well as that, you talked about how there are areas that people are often nervous talking about. So one of those, I think, is about gender recognition. Mm-hmm. So earlier, I hope the Baroness doesn't mind me calling out this, you talked in very binary terms of how it might be the person he defends or she defends. So as someone who is gender neutral, that to me was quite isolating, mm-hmm. although obviously this is something that is systemic within society. Yeah. So I just wondered, what kind of steps do you think Liberty could take when it comes to these entrenched kind of social norms in challenging things like the limitations of the Equality Act 2010 when it comes to, for example, how trans people or disabled people, hate crime against them isn't illegal unless there is violence or death threats. I just wondered, obviously there are limitations, but what kind of steps do you think we as people alongside you in solidarity could be taking to challenge these really entrenched prejudices?
Good question. I think you're right to call out the binary language, and I'm definitely culpable for that too. I think, God, if I had an answer to how to deal with entrenched social norms. So Liberty's done a fair amount of work on trans rights and will continue to do so. It's absolutely going to be a priority. I think the trans rights movement is really interesting because actually it is much more of a social and cultural movement than it is a political and legal one. And I think attitudes are probably changing socially and culturally faster than they are politically and in the law. So in many ways, I think that actually Liberty's job may be to try and get the law and Westminster and Holyrood and Stormont to catch up with changing social attitudes.
The language always trails even behind, you know, all that, you know. And of course, language is so often is so powerful that it is language that you have to challenge. And I will have to be mindful of what you've just said to me, because you do it automatically, don't you?
And I think we, you know, we know this. We know the problem of hate crime because, I mean, we've seen in the last few months a terrible rise in hate crime. We know in the last few years, year on year, there's been an increase in hate crime against Muslim communities. And I think one thing that we need to look at in particular is positive obligations. I feel like positive obligations contain a huge amount of power in asserting the rights of minority groups, whoever they are. We've seen them used to some good effect in the context of rape, where it is now recognised that under Article 3 there is an obligation to properly investigate crimes against women. And I think what we need to do is learn those lessons and learn that in the gender violence sphere, so much expertise went into this, so much thinking, so much learning, so much evidence gathering went into how to properly understand why these crimes were being committed, how then to investigate them, how to prosecute them effectively. And I think we have to have the same level of intensive understanding and learning about that across all areas of hate crime. And I agree with you, much of our legislation, Equality Act included, falls way behind, and we see it in prisons. I mean, I think the trans issues in prisons are almost where they are at their most stark, because it is there that you really have the most gender binary divisions in sometimes the most dangerous of ways. Yeah. And again, that's an example of where the human rights world may need to have those very difficult conversations, as well as, of course, supporting the more general movement around trans rights.
Please, can you bring the microphone to
you? Hi, Martha.
Hi.
This is somewhat going a different direction, but to what extent is the creeping privatisation of traditionally government functions threatening the human rights system that primarily holds governments rather than private actors to account? I think it's obviously with G4S and Obama coming out a few weeks ago about the federal system no longer relying on a private basis.
Yeah, I think the American decision to withdraw from privately run prisons is a really interesting one because it's certainly not a financially driven decision, because we know that those private companies were running prisons for half the amount of money that it costs for the state to run them. So I think there are a number of things. The first is that the great beauty of the scheme of the Human Rights Act is that, of course, it attacks people, it encompasses people who are exercising public functions. And so you don't have to be a government department in order to fall within its protections. And that has meant that you can bring human rights claims against G4S if they're running a prison, or against Serco if they're running an immigration removal centre, or privately run care homes. So in some ways, that loophole in the UK has been closed, although, of course, it's wide open again if the Human Rights Act gets repealed. I think there's a broader question about what you do if the direction of travel is increasing privatisation. Obviously, in other countries in the world, we see these private companies running whole arms of the state. Now, we don't have that in this country, but I do think that there is a real risk that by contracting out, you make the distance between the person who receives the service and the person who is accountable for providing it even greater. And so you have situations where, so for example, in many prisons, you will have one private company running the healthcare system, another private company running the discipline system, and you may have some state involvement as well. Now, when something goes wrong, it's very easy for all of those different people to say, yes, of course, the ball was dropped. but it's very hard for any of them to admit that they were the ones that dropped the ball. So I think it does raise accountability issues because there is a dispersal of power and authority, which can then make it very difficult for people to know who they are meant to be saying, actually, I have a right to be treated in this particular way by you. And that's a constant problem. And you mentioned G4S, and of course there's been the scandal in the last week about G4S being awarded the contract to provide equality and human rights advice. I mean,
you have to laugh.
You have to laugh. I'm not going to say anything else. It's laughable, so it's a real problem. It's obviously a real concern.
But developing on from that, about the idea that private companies take on the roles of the state, therefore they too should be subject to human rights expectations and standards. The big debate now, and it's very important, sitting here in Hogan Lovells, is that. This is happening now. The discussions now are around the responsibilities of the corporate world. That in fact there can be human rights abuses by the corporate world. And so we've now got the development of the Ruggie principles. Professor Ruggie did it for the UN to look at the sort of standards that one should expect of companies in their supply chains and in their treatment of employees, even in those arm's length things where they're often far removed from the headquarters of the particular outfit that that you're dealing with. So how far do you think that's likely to go? Do you see that? I mean, I see it as one of the things that's going to develop incredibly over the next decade.
Yeah.
And I think that there's more and more demand because of globalization for those responsibilities to be taken seriously and to be more than just, branding and good corporate responsibility stuff, but actually are becoming about duties and responsibilities.
Absolutely. I mean, I think that has to be the right direction of travel. I think the difficulty will always be how you hold private companies exercising private functions, so banks or property developers, to account. Because traditionally, human rights have been about dealing with the relationship between citizen and state. And I certainly think that a new frontier for the human rights conversation is how you deal with the relationship between citizen and private company, where that private company effectively has the same amount of power. I mean, I think a good example is someone like Facebook or Google. I mean, arguably, Facebook is now practically a public utility. People rely on Facebook just as much as they practically rely on their water supply. And so I think there are changing boundaries about what we consider to be public functions. And I suspect within a decade, the phrase public function may be completely anachronistic. I would say to any corporate person in the room that you can lead by example, and particularly with a Conservative government who very much wants to say that Britain is open for business and very much wants to protect the City of London. If the business world comes out in favour of human rights standards, if the business world says we will not tolerate intolerance or we are diverse and we are prioritising diversity, then that will send a very strong signal to the government and it makes it more likely that they will follow suit. So I do think there is a role in norm setting that the business and corporate world can definitely play.
Thank you. Yes, please, a hand here.
Hi, apologies in advance because my question relates to Brexit. My name's Joanna Whiteman, I'm co-director at the Equal Rights Trust. And my question, the Vote Leave campaign, I thought, did a very good job of frightening charities in advance of the referendum and making charities afraid to take a position on Brexit. And I feel that as a sector, we failed to provide a strong voice about the potential risks of Brexit. At what point will Liberties actually take a position? Because it's going to, presumably, the charity is going to have to take a position at some point, a non-neutral position.
I don't think that Liberty will take a position. Well, I know that Liberty will not take a position on whether the decision to leave the European Union is the right decision or the wrong decision. As I've said, Liberty will absolutely take a position if the implications of Brexit, like the implications of anything else, mean that human rights protection is weakened in any way. And certainly Liberty doesn't believe that the vote to leave was a vote to weaken human rights protection, and we will be very strong on that, and it's a piece of work we've already very much started working on.
So you're waiting to see what they say, basically?
No, I wouldn't say that we were waiting to see what they say, because we are clear, as clear as you can be, given the huge breadth of European law, but we know where there are rights that are derived from European law as opposed to derived from the common law. And we are therefore very alive to the fact that we need to proactively say to government, I think in coalition with other organisations like yours, this is a right. I mean, I mentioned the torture regulation, for example. I think we need to go to the government and say, if you pull out of the European Union and you don't preserve any of the regulation that exists, say, take that extreme example, one of the things that you will lose is the regulation that prevents this country from exporting equipment that might be used for torture. So can you please commit now to implementing that regulation through domestic law? And so that's just one example of the very many that there are, of course, across immigration, across criminal justice, across environmental rights, where we would proactively go to the government and say, if you don't replicate this, then we are going to be in a much worse off position.
Thank you very much.
Peter, up there, there's a hand there in the...
My name is Peter Carter. I'm a member of Doughty Street. I'm currently chairing the working party for the bar on the Investigatory Powers Bill. When the Human Rights Act comes up for debate and for reconsideration, is Liberty's position going to be defensive, or might you take the opportunity to go on the attack against the executive? What particularly I have in mind is arguing that there ought to be a provision in any new statute which either abolishes or at least severely curtails the prerogative.
That's an interesting question. The first part of your question is about Liberty's position on whether it would be defensive of the Human Rights Act, and the answer to that is absolutely we will be defensive of the Human Rights Act. We do not believe that a British Bill of Rights will offer the same protections as the Human Rights Act. I think it is absolutely fanciful if anyone thinks that a Conservative government is going to give us a British Bill of Rights that enhances our human rights protection. If anyone does think that, then I have to say I think they're naive, and I think our best hope is to defend what we have, which is an excellent working scheme. The royal prerogative is, I think, probably a different matter and probably better suited to more constitutionally minded lawyers than myself. I certainly think that we do see the use of the royal prerogative in a way that is an overreach by the executive. I think it's particularly concerning when you see now, and have seen for many years, a position in Parliament where Parliament itself is weak and the executive is strong, and that is the position now, and I don't think we're going to see that position changing. That makes the use of the royal prerogative, I think, even more problematic. Whether it's something that Liberty would specifically campaign on in the context of a debate on the Human Rights Act or just generally is not something that I've thought about, but I think it's something that we would actively consider.
Any other hands? There's a hand down here.
Tom Tarbury, 39 Essex Chambers. Building on Peter's question about going on the front foot when the debate hits us, would you go on the front foot in the sense of building, in terms of socioeconomic rights? Would that be something that, rather than hold the line, as it were, is that something that could be added? Or is that seen as something best left to primary legislation and so on? And if, despite the signs, there is repeal of the Human Rights Act and the fact that it's currently bottom of the agenda, doesn't stop it eventually being repealed. Do you think, as a second question, the common law might step up to the plate and provide some sort of equivalent protection? We've seen a lot of Supreme Court decisions of late where they've been keen to show that the equivalent protection is provided. And so does Liberty have a contingency plan to promote the common law as a equivalent protection?
I don't think we need a contingency plan. As I've said, I think the fight on the Human Rights Act is a winnable fight. I think there is very great danger in seeing it as an opportunity. Socioeconomic rights are an example of something that a Conservative government are never, ever going to allow into primary legislation. There is simply not a groundswell of support for socioeconomic rights in Westminster across the board. It's not there. You might find that kind of support in Scotland. There are those conversations in Scotland. But what would happen is if you open the door and you said, okay, you can tinker with our Human Rights Act, but can we have something back? You are not in a powerful position in that conversation. And in the end, you will not win. And you will end up with a poor cousin of what was the Human Rights Act. Much better to safeguard what we have, move past it, like I say, get rid of the planning blight, and in years to come, for all the different groups who have interest in human rights, whether it's positive obligations or socioeconomic rights or the rights of troops serving abroad, then to go on the front foot and advocate for those specific rights. Your second question was about contingency plans.
No,
sorry.
Common law.
So undoubtedly, the judges have tuned in to the political climate and are trying to move the common law into the same position as the Human Rights Act. But also undoubtedly, it doesn't provide the same complete protection. And it doesn't do that in a number of areas, including privacy is a very good example. The common law on privacy is nowhere near what the common law, what the privacy-led jurisprudence is under Article 8. And also, of course, what you don't get with the common law is that wonderful scheme of the Human Rights Act, which is to say, for example, in the end, you can go to a supervisory court that sets standards across Europe and you can have your case decided there. And that is just one example of something that we would lose if we only had the common law to rely on. And so it's great to catch up the common law as much as we can with the HRA, but there are very distinct areas, including, for example, fair trial rights, where there just isn't the jurisprudence and there's no prospect really of developing it.
I think it's important on the whole issue of social and economic rights to recognise that, for example, one of the things that I'm fearful of in Brexit is that the protection of certain social rights does come to us through European Union law. I mean, around employment, for example, pensions, and so there are some areas where it isn't. The European Convention that gives us protections, but it's actually this other area. It's also interesting that though, when you do have a conversation with the general public and say, what would you like to have in a British Bill of Rights? They always say education and health are two of the things which governments will never give them. Not make a promise to say, we are going to make sure that you have education cradle to grave free of charge or whatever. I mean, they'll find a way around that. But it's a very, very, as we know, it's a very useful thing, a tool for change, particularly in the developing world. I mean, if you're in South Africa, you see how powerful it is as a mechanism for change and for moving a country to a different place. But I don't think, I don't think it's very likely that it's going to suddenly have much purchase with politicians here across the divide. I mean, I'm not speaking for necessarily Labour's leadership just now, but there are a whole lot of people in the Labour Party who wouldn't buy into it either, I'm afraid. So, up there. Please. Can I have a little show of any more hands there? Okay.
Hi both. My name's Chloe. I'm a law student. I'm really, really interested in human rights. My question for you, Martha, is I believe that someone in your position, you do the work that you do because, as you described earlier, you have that fire in your belly and you have that passion. How do you rein yourself in when your personal opinions, for example, Liberty being neutral on the Brexit vote, when you feel that your personal opinions might conflict the work that you do or that you don't want to bring your personal beliefs too far into your work for the fear of alienating other people in society?
Hold on to that because I'm going to quickly take two more because we're winding up. There was a hand there and then there was Morris, there's a hand. Right, so there's somebody here in the front row and then... Yeah.
That's actually a very good question because I wouldn't have that one, but that's not what I want to ask. I do feel this is like the triangle of terror right here. You did touch upon, briefly mentioned, the abuse of women and the criminalisation of crimes against women. Mm. Now, I'm actually a trustee of Nottingham Women's Centre, and Nottingham Police is the first force in the country to have made it or to record crimes against women. Yeah. So actually what I want to do is, if you're available,
it's very naughty.
There is a conference.
You have to do it after. Come on, I'm not having conferences arranged. Time's short. Morris, up there, please. You can have a conversation about that later, but that's not useful. Thank you.
Thank you. Maurice McSweeney from Doughty Street. The UK was one of the early architects of the convention, and you know, for hundreds of years has actually been a real leading light in terms of human rights and civil liberties. And we go around the country telling other we go around the world telling other countries what they should be doing in relation to human rights. What do you think might happen to human rights and civil liberties internationally if there's a repeal of the Human Rights Act and other countries see the UK apparently resigning from its long-standing human rights and civil liberties commitment?
Martha, I'm going to take that one first because I want us to, because I like that question and I'd like us to have a lot of chance with it. I'm sorry, I'm going to have to wind this up. What, you know, the impact, I mean, does it matter? Do people pay attention to what happens in Britain? And if we were to repeal the Human Rights Act, what would people out there think? Would it give permission to Putin to become even worse?
Yeah, I think unquestionably it would, because the UK is a very well-developed country. It still has a lot of influence in many parts of the world. It prides itself on having influence in many parts of the world. And of course, if the UK sends a signal, which is this is something that is disposable, then I think unquestionably not only will others follow, but they will feel emboldened to do so. And I think that will be Putin, and I think that will be other dictatorial leaders, but I also think it will be less awful people. It will just give credence to the mission creep that we've already talked about, which is to say there can be erosion across the board, even in countries where you wouldn't necessarily expect it. And so I think it is a very grave threat to human rights internationally. And that's something, I mean, Liberty is a member of a number of these international organisations that bring together civil liberties groups from different countries, and they are very, very afraid that this will be the beginnings of a domino effect of human rights protection.
Now, that question that our friend, the law student, asked is a really important one, because it's one of those things that continues to confront me, because I've been in the process recently of creating an Institute of Human Rights at Oxford, where I'm the head of one of the colleges. And talking to certain lawyers at Oxford, you'd think that human rights were somehow social work or, you know, development work and not real law. And so there's this sense in which the people who want to do this kind of thing are obviously bleeding hearts who are going to over-emote and to over-identify with their clients. That's what, and judges will always sort of say these kinds of things, even if it's couched in a slightly different language. The sense in which that people who choose to do this, motivated by passion in the way that you describe, that passion is an unhealthy thing to exist within the legal parameters. I'm a firm believer in passion. Anyway, more of it is what I say. But there is that question, which is, how do you rein it in when something gets to you, and yet you're having to be a representative of liberty or representative of a client, and you're having to kind of restrain the kind of rage where you want to hit the judge on the head with a hammer.
Yeah, I mean, it's a rage I'm really very familiar with. I think when you're doing, you know, liberty is my job, and it's a fantastic job, and inevitably I feel very passionately about the issues that I'm working on there, and that's why I applied for the job and it's why I went to the bar. And so maybe my job takes up more space in my mind and more time with my friends and my family than for other people, but it is a job, and I do have opinions about things that are completely irrelevant to Liberty's work. And I think that the way that you deal with the personal opinion issue is that my job at Liberty is to do everything that I can to protect human rights, to try and advocate for people to make progressive decisions, progressive policies, for people to understand why human rights are important, to show them why human rights are important. If there is an issue like Brexit, and I am persuaded that if I gave away my own views on Brexit, it would damage the cause of furthering human rights, then that's how I find it very easy to keep my own personal opinions to myself, because it's not going to help me saying what those opinions are in front of someone whose mind I'm trying to change about something completely separate. And so that's how you do it. You look at your own credibility and you look at your own ability to persuade, and if those things would be damaged by personal rants about whatever it is, how much footballers are paid or whatever, then that's very easy to shelve those personal things. And then, of course, you go to the pub with your friends in the evening and you rant about
the fact that I've just moved to London Fields and loads of people pee in the street all the time, and it really annoys me. It's not a liberty issue, you know, so it's not... So, I don't know, it's kind of...
They think it is a liberty issue.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, listen, it's been really wonderful having this opportunity of hearing what you're doing, what your plans are, what you see as being things that are going to confront us all, I think, as the rights and liberties issues in the next years. And I just think it's a source of celebration that we have someone as wonderful as you heading up this precious organisation. And I hope that everybody in this room will think about joining Eva in the Human Rights Lawyers Association. And I really do think that we should make it a regular thing that we have an opportunity of sitting with you and reminding ourselves of why it all matters. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.